You bought 8 pins. You bought 2?
2 pins.
Okay, good, thank you.
I'm sorry, sir.
Oh.
Is it open?
Yeah.
Yes, you can go down. I was just going to.
Board member?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Don, excellent. RJ Morris, very nice to meet you, sir.
Morris.
Thank you very much. Yes. Oh, Angela, very nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you very much.
This is your meeting packet.
Oh, Lord. Okay.
Including your information.
But it's got other stuff in here, not just me. Okay, good, good, good.
Thank you.
Nydia, right?
Nydia.
Nydia, okay.
Is this a decision?
Yeah, that's the ethics, that's the ethics decision. Did you want me to pull the complaint as well?
No, I thought there was something a little bit more detailed that we had.
Well, the whole file was huge, but that was the board's decision. And then there was a, like a legal memorandum and then it basically stated the same thing. It's about a paragraph.
All right, I think that's what we were looking to get.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
You'll have to print them out in the future.
No, not necessarily, though. That's just for your reading. Okay. I'm always going to have a packet for you all.
I'm going to be with that.
Okay.
Hey, thank you for that.
You're welcome.
How are you doing?
Can I get
the back? 3-page
back? Yes, you may.
How are you, sir?
Did you call me? Oh, I'm sorry.
How's it going?
I know, right?
So do you what?
You too.
Yeah, we're about 10 minutes or so, make sure everybody is supposed to be here is here.
I How are you in the first one?
I'm good.
Well, that's fine, you're entitled to it.
Oh, this one, okay, thank you. I will sit this way.
Yeah, okay. All right.
Are we all here, present, accounted for? Okay. I did see somebody go out the window, I mean, not the, the window, yet, anyway, go out the door. Okay, I think I would declare that a quorum is present, and we will begin our meeting on April the 2nd, 2014. Presented before you are the minutes. I mean, the meeting agenda. Are there any additions, corrections, order revisions? If not, then the chair will entertain a motion to approve the meeting agenda of April 2nd, 2014.
I so move.
And with a second?
Second.
Okay, probably moved and seconded. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, it appears to be unanimous. For introductory purposes, let the board members introduce themselves, and if anyone would like to introduce themselves and their affiliations, I'd appreciate it.
Pardon me, Chairman. I didn't know if we were going to review the minutes. I thought we were only doing a motion for the agenda, but I did want to address some concerns with the minutes whenever the...
Yeah, we'll do that. I skipped over the welcome and introduction, so we'll do that and then come back to the adoption of the minutes.
Okay.
I'm Attorney Donald Edwards. I'm Chair of the Fulton County Board of Ethics, appointed by the Commissioners.
Woody Sampson, counsel to the board.
JaDawnya Butler, appointed by the Gate City Bar Association.
Julian, called Atlanta Business League.
Good morning, Mercedes Miller. I was appointed by the Airport Chamber of Commerce.
Carrie Johnson, and I represent the Personnel Board of Fulton.
Marty Locke, I have been appointed by the Greater North Fulton Chamber of Commerce.
Benjamin Fox, I'm the Vice Chairman, and I was nominated by the Atlanta Bar Association.
Angela Grayson, I'm the Clerk of the Fulton County Board of Ethics, and I was appointed by Chairman Edwards.
All right. Oh, anyone on the front row here?
Sure. R.J. Morris, R.J. Morris Tax Activist.
Okay. Mr. Anderson?
Yes, sir.
Would you like to introduce yourself?
George Anderson, here regarding a complaint.
Okay.
David Wickert with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution.
Okay, thank you. Are you with the Atlanta Journal-Constitution?
No, sir. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I'm a citizen journalist, and I post on YouTube.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
In the back, please.
Gladys Bradfield.
I'm Gladys Bradfield, Tax Administrator.
Terry Noble, Tax Administrator, Tax Administrator.
The Philly Gun Tax Commissioner.
Bill Dodson, attorney representing Dr. Ferdinand.
Rodney Floyd, tax administrator. Okay.
I want to thank everybody for being here. There's one little correction is that all of our members are of the board are nominated by the groups that you've heard, but they are confirmed by the Board of Commissioners, Fulton County Board of Commissioners. We will go to item number three now, the adoption of the minutes of our February 18th meeting. And is there any comment, revision, correction?
Yes, Chairman. Good morning, everyone. I was reviewing the minutes, and thank you very much to our clerk, Ms. Grayson, for putting them together. My only comment would be that I think the minutes should reflect what was done, not necessarily what was said, because I think that recounting, at least Robert's rules of order say so, in accounting everything that was said, there's some things that are left out, and there's some things that were said by some people, and it's showing that it was said by another. So that's my only concern in doing that I think the minutes should be more reflective of what was done versus what was said. If we do agree as a board to move forward with what was said, then I can give some notes that I think would help better reflect what was done and said on that day.
Well, is there anything in specific that you'd like to ask us to amend?
If we're gonna
just as a general matter going forward, deal with minutes that are more cursory,
sure,
and relate only to the subject and what was done?
Yes. If we do choose to move forward with the minutes as presented, then I have a couple of recommendations to better represent everything that was said and done, if that would be helpful. And then we can record the minutes as what was done versus what was said as we move forward. I defer to the board on that. I just wanted to at least bring it up.
Okay. Can you give me a as it relates to this particular minutes, is there anything that you wanted to revise or amend or add or subtract?
Yes, sir. There can just be three notes. Starting on page 3 of the minutes, under the second paragraph that state, or the first full paragraph, the board heard testimony. After that paragraph, and before my motion, our board counsel suggested that probable cause can be based on the evidence presented by the complainant. Yeah. And in response to that, I made a motion that we find that there is no probable cause based on the evidence presented by the complainant.
Okay.
Subsequent to that, in the next paragraph that's describing the evidence presented by Dr. Ferdinand, I believe it was Ms. Radfield, that presented much of the information that's noted in here, and not necessarily Dr. Ferdinand. I remember that she presented the information of the carbon copy cashier's check and explained the process and procedure of what was kept in the folder and things of that nature. And lastly, maybe in that last paragraph, I would, since we noted earlier a motion being made and withdrawn, I would maybe add down here that a motion was made again and then the board voted unanimously. And if it's helpful to give Ms. Grayson or get with Ms. Grayson on those, I can do that. I just want to make the board aware of my suggestions to the minutes.
Well, we will reformat the minutes with your suggestions, and the language can be agreed upon between you and Ms. Grayson, clerk. And we'll try to be more, either more brief or provide more information as it relates to why actions were made and when they were made. Okay? All right. No problem. Anything else? All right. There being, is there a motion to approve the minutes as amended, as suggested by Member JaDawnya Butler?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the minute with the necessary correction as represented here by Mr. Butler.
Okay, thank you. All right, there being a motion and properly seconded to amend the minutes as suggested by Member Butler in consultation with the clerk. We will have those amended minutes also available for review and discussion at our next meeting. Anything would prohibit us from now going into our old business? Okay. First item of our old business is a continuation of the complaint by Mr. Anderson referencing certain actions and activities of Commissioner Ferdinand. Does everybody have the specifics of that? We were, as I recall, that those particular allegations came to us either at or closely before the before our meeting in February, and we didn't feel that the commissioner was given the amount of time that is due to review and respond to those particular allegations. And Mr. Counsel, can you state for us in particular what the additional allegations were that were not disposed of at our previous meeting?
Well, I know there were two issues that we talked about at the last meeting as being not violations of the ethics code, that they were consistent with, number one, Georgia law and county policy. One issue that was talked about was this issue with the use of county funds for a personal vehicle for Dr. Ferdinand to use. And I believe it was discussed at the last meeting that use was consistent with county policy, and there had not been really a showing of a violation of any county policy or ethics code violation, which would cause us to cause the board to investigate that particular issue. And in the decision letter that was issued on February 20th, 2014, in the first footnote, that was discussed, that particular allegation against Dr. Ferdinand was not considered based on the fact that it was consistent with county policy. That was also the same for Dr. Ferdinand's compensation that he received. And I believe that what was discussed was that was currently consistent with Georgia law, that Dr. Ferdinand was in compliance with Georgia law, and there had not been any allegation that he had violated the law in either collecting this money or receiving this money. So those two issues were not considered. What appears to be new issues in this particular complaint, and I think there are two issues, new issues. One dealing directly with a board member, JaDawnya Butler, in terms of her having a conflict of interest, in terms of her sitting and deciding the issues which were presented at the last hearing. So that's one issue that's outstanding. The second issue that I believe is outstanding is the issue as it relates to Commissioner Houseman regarding an alleged retaliation. In reviewing, and maybe Mr. Anderson, if there's additional issues which need to be decided, from my reading of the amended complaint and the second complaint and the amended complaint, those are, I think, the two issues that are on the table. Is that?
Chairman, if I could just state that the three I have down, I think you covered all three. The number one was retaliation against Commissioner Houseman by Dr. Ferdinand. Two was conflict of interest by a Board of Ethics member.
Okay.
Ms. Butler. Three, conservation use assessment. Those were the three I had down. I think you covered two of those three. There might have been one there that you did not.
Okay, what was the third one? I'm sorry.
The third one was involving 68, I think, or approximately 68 to 70 acres in South Fulton County, where Dr. Ferdinand has used his office for private gain, personal gain, and that was the one that I sent you, Chairman, after the February 18th hearing that we had. So there were two on the 18th of February, and then there was one that was included and documented by a letter by the chairman back to me. Those are the three today.
And if I might, I'm sorry, I said my back the other day. If I might leave that with you so you can plan for the next one, that's a new complaint. Against Dr. Ferdinand.
And you can table it for the next meeting.
It would be good to try to consolidate, maybe at the end of the year, all of your complaints you have with Dr. Ferdinand.
Well, there's so much corruption, it's just, you know, it just keeps seeping out through air vents, and it's like it's gone viral, so, Chairman. I will try to keep it simple, follow the KISS principle, but unfortunately, there's been items like this right here that I just finished up in the last few days, and I asked the board, understanding that my typing on it for about 8-9 hours, I knew I needed to be here today, but the typing and everything's messed up my back, so please be patient with me as far as getting around today. But it is a legitimate allegation, and I ask the board to consider it for the next year.
Okay. With respect to the third issue that you had that you just discussed, can you just kind of orientate me in the complaint where that's located?
Okay, that is, let's see. If you look on page one, back on 218,
right.
There is a one listed after A under nature of action, and that is involving the Liz Hausman, the Fulton County Commissioner. Now, if you go, to page 3 or 4, get over there. I'm sorry, page 5. You go all the way up to page 5, and I distinctly remember the chairman mentioning these two at the last meeting. Okay. But this one is I, and it's involving the South Fulton property, and the it talks about the conservation use assessment, where the tax commissioner, through his knowledge or gaining knowledge, has violated the public's trust by gaining again in any way, shape, or form he can private gain that other Fulton County citizens have perhaps the ability to do some of this type of, I think he's received, I've got it down in one of my documents today for you, about he's received over $40,000 from the federal government. And this is a gentleman now that is making more than any other elected official in the state of Georgia. And I have a lot of material dealing with the conservation use assessment that I'd like to share with the board today.
So as we have boiled it down, there are three issues. One involving a member, JaDawnya Butler, which, if I understand your complaint, is that as a Fulton County employee, she presents a conflict of interest in deciding matters of Fulton County employees and officers in this body, including Dr. Ferdinand.
Well, Chairman, I was hoping a moment ago that you would say what you said right after this gentleman here, and I'm glad that you remembered and stated it across the board, the table here. But Chairman, this body is nominated by associations or, and you stated correctly, you said when you were identifying yourself that you were appointed. Each member is appointed by the Board of Commissioners. They are nominated by different associations, different groups. And in so doing, you're still, unfortunately, I've got one today I want to recommend to you, and I'm going to leave a copy of the Gwinnett County Code of Ethics, because I believe sincerely the Board of Commissioners should really look at that, and this board should look at it. It takes it away from the commissioners appointing members to the board and puts it in the hands of citizens and one commissioner from a different county, one commissioner from the Association of County Commissioners Association, and I'll leave that Gwinnett County Code of Ethics for this board to look at. But what I'm trying to get out of my mouth is that in dealing with Board of Ethics member Butler, we're into about 11:10, and we think we finished up on the 18th of February, and correct me if I'm wrong, any member of the board chairman, but I think we finished in the range of close to 1 o'clock or between 12:30 and 1. She made the motion after 70 minutes to dismiss the complaint. She is the only one on this board that is a paid employee in Fulton County. I have flowcharts that I want to hand to you that show from the top on down. These flowcharts are available online dealing with the Fulton County Commission, the government structure, the district attorney's office here, the tax commissioner here. You use the Venn diagram and you see where Ms. Butler, tax commissioner, Dr. Ferdinand are in the middle of the Venn diagram. They are working for the same government, and the other members of this board, although I don't agree with and there's nothing you can do at this point to change it, but it should be, as I suggested, please look at the Gwinnett County Code of Ethics. But at this time, you're appointed by the Board of Commissioners, but each one of you, except for Ms. Butler, are Fulton County citizens, as you sent to me either in a letter or an email, and I appreciate that, sir. But what bothers me is Ms. Butler works in the county government, and no other member on this board does so. The appearance of impropriety, that is a concern, and the conflicts of interest, both of them are receiving paychecks from the Fulton County government structure. And if I have a moment, I will hand you that flow chart, or I will, when I have an opportunity, to give you a few exhibits.
Well, let's take up this issue. The chair takes notice that Ms. Butler, Attorney Butler, was nominated by the Gate City Bar Association, and her nomination was confirmed and was appointed by the Fulton County Commission. On a date. Has served on this board now for 5 years, and that her job is in the Fulton County District Attorney's Office in the Public Integrity Unit, and which calls her to have a responsibility to oversee and prosecute Fulton County officers and employees. And what you're asking us is that she should not sit on the
Fulton County Board of Ethics because she's a Fulton County employee, but that her job results in her investigating and prosecuting Fulton County employees and officers. So it seems to me that she would not be beholden in any way to any person who is a Fulton County employee, particularly one that is not in her chain of supervision, which might make a difference, for example, if Paul Howard was brought before this commission. There may be a point at that where your complaint would be valid, but from the chair's perspective, it is not, as it relates to Ms. Butler and Dr. Ferdinand. Would anybody else like to speak to that issue?
Mr. Anderson? Are you alleging that Dr. Ferdinand has any discretionary authority over Ms. Butler's compensation or her job?
No, I'm alleging that Ms. Butler has bias, some type of perhaps even social contact with fellow Fulton County employee, and then Dr. Arthur Ferdinand. I'm also stating that Ms. Butler was very quick to make a motion. I mean, we had only gone about less than half of the meeting slash hearing on February 18th. I don't know if she just wanted to get this over with, or if she has some type of favoritism and in some kind of way she just wanted to quickly dismiss the complaint. But they are both paid Fulton County employees. You're not, sir. Neither is the other members of the board. I have noted that the attorney for the board has been the attorney for the board for over a decade. I don't know why this is continued, but at this time I don't know of any conflict of interest involving, is it Mr. Sampson?
It is.
I wanted to pronounce it correctly. And Chairman, being appointed by the Board of Commissioners really can be a type of straitjacket for this board, because you are nominated by these different associations, but you are indeed approved by the Board of Commissioners. I'm only stating on one member that is employed by the Fulton County Commissioners, and seeing very quickly that she wanted to dismiss a very important complaint, a very important matter involving a Fulton County employee that she has in common as being another employee. Even though she's an assistant district attorney, she is not an elected official. She is an employee along with an elected official slash employee. In fact, Dr. Ferdinand was an employee for many years before they changed the legislation to running for elective office. So we have a situation here where the Board of Ethics should take a look and be very broad-minded on transparency, be very broad-minded on whether I have brought to you something that you would like to just state that there is no conflict and let's put this under the rug like we did February 18th, or if you might want to think about this because it is a legitimate issue. I noticed, Chairman, that you, back at the first complaint 10 years ago on the Commissioner Ferdinand, was either the chairman, I believe you were the chairman, and then I think maybe some years transpired and you came off this board, but I have noted that you were here about 10 years ago when the complaint filed against Dr. Ferdinand, and I believe at that time you were chairman, and I believe I was contacted and was very cordially and very professionally taken care of by Ms. Grayson, and that was 2003-2004. Now, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong there, but I think it's legitimate to question whether Ms. Butler has any reason to have a conflict of interest, the appearance of impropriety, the appearance of recusal, so that there will not be any smoke over the procedure here dealing with this complaint or allegation.
All right, I think Member Butler had, when she reviewed the minutes, referenced the absence of a discussion from our counsel that, based upon the testimony of the complainant, that it would be an appropriate time to make a motion. And in the legal sense of the process, many times, you know, the complainant is given an opportunity to give their best shot, and if that is not sufficient in and of itself, there's no other duty on the part of the respondent or the defendant in a criminal case to counteract those allegations with a defense. And I think Member Butler, in that framework and with that information, made her motion. I don't think that it was untimely. I don't think it was an expression of bias. At least I'm speaking for myself as chair. But it was my suggestion to her that we await Dr. Ferdinand's response, because I thought he would be entitled to one rather than have an allegation kind of hanging out there. And with, in the balance of your allegations and his defense, we felt that his defense was sufficient for us to make a determination that there was not any probable cause. So at this point, is there any other discussion as it relates to the issue of Member Butler?
I'd just like to make sure that we have a complete record from Mr. Anderson. You raised the question of potential favoritism or bias on behalf of Ms. Butler. Do you have any evidence to present of favoritism or bias above and beyond you citing to the motion that you raised in the last meeting?
And a flow chart or an organizational chart, which I will present.
I apologize, I had my ink cartridge run out, but in that crude drawing, the only
you see how the flow up here
is Fulton County in both of the diagrams, and in the middle, the two Fulton County employees, Ms. Butler, Dr. Ferdinand. I do not find a single member of this board eligible for that connection.
Mr. Chairman, whether I'd just like to say whether Attorney Butler is a Fulton County employee or not, I believe she does just as all of us on this board would look at the facts openly, objectively, impartially, and reach an unbiased decision. And that's just fine.
And for a point of clarity for the board, is, you know, in terms of me giving my legal opinion, the code itself prescribes who is eligible and who is not. And it does not prohibit a Fulton County employee from serving on the ethics board. And I think it would be improper for the board, in my mind, to basically enter into the purview of the Board of Commissioners. If there needs to be changes, or there are changes with respect to the composition of the board and who's on the board, that's in the purview of the Board of Commissioners and not the ethics board, unless there is a direct conflict of a member in terms of a particular matter that's being heard. And that's just my legal opinion about that.
Chair, I'm going to take any motion. A motion to dismiss the complaint of not having probable cause. In reference to Member Butler's participation in the past matter of Dr. Ferdinand and any other forthcoming matters involving Dr. Ferdinand.
I raise that motion.
Is there a second?
I second.
Okay. You're properly moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those that favor by the same sign. Okay, it's been unanimous. And we will note that and provide you with that decision in writing, Mr. Anderson. Now, as we turn to Commissioner Hausman. Your complaint states, when elected official Ferdinand uses his public office against an elected official or citizen for spite and retaliation, section 2.66 of Declaration of Board of Ethics Policy has been violated. Commissioner Ferdinand did use his public office to retaliate against Liz M. Hausman, Fulton County Commissioner, utilizing her First Amendment right of free speech. Commissioner Hausman had questioned the tax commissioner's purchase of public funds of a 2013 county vehicle for his personal and work use. Is that the sum of your complaint, Mr. Anderson?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you want to add briefly anything to that allegation?
You have enough room. Is it permissible to?
Yes.
Is
it permissible?
Yeah, come on, please. I didn't mean to have you as a backbencher on your complaint.
What information did you want, sir?
If there was any other specific information to add to that complaint, other than what we already have. Commissioner Hausman and Dr. Ferdinand's actions in reference.
You do a copy of this. I am serious about that and much better code. You work with what you've got, I understand. I am a citizen that has looked at a lot of ethics codes. Responding to that allegation. I received it.
owned. And I thank you, Ms. Grayson. But thank you, Ms. Grayson, because I would have only gotten this if you had emailed it to me. I got a very first email me copy just 2 days ago. Reading through it, word for word, sentence, paragraph, pages. Mr. Turner is doing his job to represent Commissioner Ferdinand. It does not change what is in this complaint, this lawsuit about against him or what he did. In fact, looking through here, it's mainly, as I put in comments to this board today that I'll leave with you, it's a case really of deny, which attorneys do. You know, they can speak for their client, they can tell the court that's not true. Tell the news media, I've seen it done many times, that's not true, our client's innocent. But the bottom line here is, facts show that the commissioner did exactly as 15 years ago text commissioner did to me. I was in the courthouse in Floyd County and had a case of against the Floyd County Commission. And we found out the local Bum News Tribune and other newspapers and the tax office, revenue department. I was the only one that had ever had his bank account seized because he wanted to retaliate against me for filing the complaint against what the county commissioners had done. They had quit playing the public hospital in Rome. It's so familiar that I wanted to add it at this meeting today because it's so much Jim Ford at the time, thank goodness he's retiring, because he was as corrupt as, now he couldn't be as corrupt as Ferdinand, but he was very corrupt. And he was in office about 30-something years. But I was the only citizen ever had that done. Prosy account, because he was saying that I was 15 days behind on $423 on my bookstore at the time of Rome. Now, in this case here,
we haven't got scored here yet, right? Just raise your hand. Swear the testimony you've given in this matter is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth to help you, God.
Yes, sir. I do. You don't mind if we have my water. County Ethics Board Chairman, I think you will find if I read some of the materials or if you have had an opportunity to read. First, let me ask the board. You have this sent to you, probably through Ms. Grayson. Has anyone had an opportunity to look at the lawsuit filed against the tax commissioner for what he did in a vendetta because he wanted to get back to the county commissioner that used freedom of speech, used her rights, and asked some questions about the tax commissioner's purchase of a county vehicle for $39,000. She asked some questions about how his income had zoomed up. Nothing had ever happened until she made those inquiries. After that, we have a vendetta by a public official that I think is terrible. I hope the members of this board both believe that it was awful too, because I have dug deep into everything that occurred to this commissioner. And, you know, it's not an easy thing at all as far as trying to be an elected official. It is not an easy thing to do to try to handle that and go through a divorce and take care of the 24-year-old, because we still have one that at 24 doesn't
doesn't have her head on straight, but it takes a few years. Commissioner Hausman, from what I can tell, it's like I've studied Ms. Butler's resume, which was very, very exceptional, very good. What I wanted to say concerning the commissioner's actions, Chairman, is that it's like maybe, just like County Commission Chairman Mike Ken, he just felt like he's got the power, he's got the ability, he can come back every time and say, everything I did was illegal. So I have a response to that, brought it today for the board, where I'm saying, if you allow me to read some off of it, and I'll tell you some from memory. He had an opportunity to do as he said he does February 18th, sit down with the commissioner, he sat down with Mayor Kasim Reed, took care of his problem, and redid the book through the clerk of court for the mayor. Seems that he was not willing to do that with Commissioner Hausman because she had said some things that needed to be said. Question your elected officials. The boss is the citizens. So I get dry mouth, sir. But what I'm saying to this board today is that I look at what you asked me a moment ago, and I think, you know, from February 18th to 30 days after, the code says something about getting some kind of response. Because, sir, Chairman and the attorney for the board, I received a response from Dr. Ferdinand's attorney, and you sent me a copy. Or they sent me a copy, I don't remember which, but in this case, you sent me a copy email, thank you. And then another 15 days go by, 45 days from February 18th to the 31st when I received it. So, you know, I don't know if they've just got a real bad caseload, but aren't they supposed to get back to this board on something such as this before 45 days? Didn't I read something about 30 days? It does say something about you getting out a letter to them within 5 days, but I was trying to ascertain from this board today if this response was untimely and late. But concerning it, this is talking about a court action involving May 2013. Again, what we're talking about, put these aside, what we're talking about here is not, I heard this, Chairman, so many times over the last 18, 19 years. I'd have a commission chairman from the State of Georgia Board of Ethics say, this is called the Board of Ethics, but we do look at the law. So I have learned that, you know, all these are given the name Board of Ethics. After Watergate in the 70s, it went around all over this country. But you also have the ability, this board does, this board has the ability to do something in the gray. In the law, you got black and white, black and white. There is gray. I mean, I did have a newspaper man one day years ago, six, 7 years ago, a decade ago, say something about Anderson does not see anything but black and white. You're either done something wrong, or he thinks you didn't do something right. But I feel sincerely there is an area for the Board of Ethics to look at this, because you have harassment, you have use of office for a type of private gain where you mess with a person's life, you give them an arbitrary 7 days to get information taken care of that is not in the law. You have an attorney, Josh Belafont, that I have had defending several clients at the State Ethics Commission and he was also a state ethics board member, saying that, you know, this was done, that was done, going to the take care of, it boils down to everything showed that she was living at the place she stated. Your commissioner, your Floyd County commissioner, has been harmed. She's been harmed emotionally. She's been harmed ethically. And in this lawsuit, they'll handle what's legally. But it states in here that they want more time. I sent an email to you. I believe you should have a copy of it, where I was stating that I believe they have plenty of time. I mean, I just got notice of this on the 31st. Monday. What I'm saying is, if I can look at this one moment and go to the part dealing with Houseman, I will do that very quickly.
If you can hold off on that, Mr. Anderson, I believe we received and sent to you the letter and email.
2 days ago.
Yeah, and I think we received it 2 days ago as well, and we sent it right on to you, and we also sent, at the request of the AJC, a copy to the AJC. Would you agree that the subject matter of this dispute in the court patterns your dispute that you have made in your ethics complaint?
I believe that the Fulton County Commissioners, the employees and officials of Fulton County government are fully covered through the Code of Ethics. Everything I have read and read again on Codes of Ethics, this covers officials, elected officials, public servants, as well as employees. This Board of Ethics has an opportunity to do something rather than just put it off and say, well, let's just let the courts decide what they're going to do. I mean, if I could just state a couple items here.
Well, before you do again.
Well, what you're wanting to do, sir, is put it with the court and say, Mr. Anderson, you know, we really, as a Board of Ethics, there are sections, Chairman. This board could do something involving a clear vindictive vendetta, because it worked with Chairman Mike Ken, Chairman of the Fulton County Commission. Let's do it again. When you have an official that stops being a public servant and all he's concerned with is selling those liens to Vesta Holdings and making $400,000 a year, and that bill in the legislature last week went nowhere. You've got a situation here where you really ought to give some thought to doing something about an individual who's taking advantage of the federal government with all this federal money. He's taking advantage of the, that's, whether it's federal or it's state or it's local, it's taxes by the citizens.
Let's keep it the house for the moment.
Let's keep it on the house. When the houseman has gone through the ringer, if you look at the court document, and I'd be glad to have anyone look at it that has not seen it, but it states exactly what happened. And this is saying, oh no, the commissioner had the right to do it, and the commissioner bent over backwards to help Commissioner Hout. I had the same thing happen, Chairman, 15 years ago. Tax commissioner in Floyd County said, an anonymous person told me that I needed to look at your taxes. You know, we found out that in 30 years, 40 years, no one had ever had a bank account done like this, except a citizen activist that had a lawsuit against the county commission. Now, what I'm saying to you here is, you can't have elected officials here in Fulton County getting away with this type of unethical behavior.
Let me help you out, Mr. Henderson.
Let me finish this, Mr. Henderson. Board of Ethics needs to look at what limited scope you have and see if you can do something, whether it's, I'm not the enemy. I want to say to you, Mr. Sampson, I just want something done that benefits the citizens, because this
and that's wrong. That's what I'm trying to help you out with, because, you know, again, in this hearing, I'm going to give the board instructions on really the standard that they're to apply when making a decision.
Okay. Yes, sir.
And so really what I'm trying to help you with is for you to focus in on the things that are going to help this board make a decision. My first question to you, other than the complaint that you have, do you have any other documentation with you that indicates that there was some unethical conduct that occurred? That's the first question, and I don't want you to answer it. The second question is, do you have any direct involvement yourself in any of the transaction that took place with Commissioner Hausman and Arthur Ferdinand? Do you have any personal knowledge, or do you have any witnesses that have personal knowledge? Because that's the type of evidence that the board is going to need to consider whether or not an ethical violation occurred. I understand you have the complaint, but the complaint is just like the complaint that you filed. It's an allegation. That's not evidence. That's something that somebody alleges. Evidence would be witnesses or documentation, which would show or prove. And in this case, this board has to make a decision that in terms of finding probable cause, they must have a reasonable belief that something has occurred. And that must be based on evidence.
Yes, sir.
That must be based on witnesses. That must be based on documentation. That must be based on personal knowledge. So if you have anything that relates to personal knowledge of this transaction, any document that relates to this transaction other than the complaint that's filed, then
couldn't exhibits that have documentation and state facts that are placed into evidence in Fulton County Court, isn't that a type of documentation? Now, I will say this, Mr. Sampson, I agree with you. You know, if I had 5, 10, even 50 or 60 citizens here today that said I have been wronged by the tax commissioner of Fulton County, but I don't think a single citizen, I don't think a single one wants to try to do something, because he's gonna exact revenge on them. I mean, it's happened here with a commissioner, an elected official. Now, it happened before with the chairman of the county commission dealing with a couple of his stores years ago. You've got a situation here where this man believes he can do no wrong, and if he doesn't, he's not going to get caught. If he gets caught, he's not going to have any type of judgment on it. No justice is going to take place. No decision by this board. Well, I hope, Chairman, that you will ask the members to think concerning what I've got together here today in a manner that this is unethical. It is very, very much personal. It's personal to Commissioner Hausman. Now, Mr. Sampson, you asked me a question a moment ago. I missed, and I apologize.
Yeah, I was asking about whatever personal knowledge that you had, other than what's been attached to the complaint.
I have got to the point in age where this worked out perfect for me. February 18th I had to make arrangements, but this worked out perfectly because this is week of spring break, and so April 2nd, or I would contact you and ask for another date if possible. But when I'm not teaching kids, I am trying to do something, whether it be Cook County, Adel, Georgia, months ago, 2 years I spent in Gwinnett County, Forsyth County. What I'm saying to you is, this has nothing personal to do with me, but it's very personal to me because I have been concerned about elected officials or even employees that violate the public's trust. When you look at what it says in the Georgia Constitution, it says that you are trustees of the public funds. You have a fiduciary duty. Now, if Dr. Ferdinand is so anxious to put all these liens over there at the Vesta and other third-party collection companies, he's interested more in making more in his pocket, in his paycheck, in his annual paycheck, or in his job is no longer to serve the taxpayers and get a small salary of $137,000, which to me is a lot of money. I never saw that teaching. But what I'd say to you is, you've got an official that just believes he can do whatever he wants.
Let me point of clarity. These documents that you handed me, these were documents that were what? Where did these come from?
Those documents come from.
They were attached to the complaint. Is that right?
Complaints. Yes, sir. They
asked me to copy the complaint.
Yeah.
And the complaint is listing documentation. And it's not like you can say, this is Mr. Sampson. You can't look at me and say, this is hearsay or off of the newspaper.
Well, no. What I would say to you is if this is your evidence, then you need to pinpoint in this stack the documents which prove that there's a conflict of interest.
Okay.
Or that there's a violation of ethics code.
Thank you.
And Mr. Anderson, while this is a verified complaint, it's pled on information and belief, which doesn't mean that the person who verified the complaint had personal knowledge of all the specifics identified in the complaint. A complaint is an evidence, it's an allegation like your complaint, which was the point that Mr. Edwards was trying to make.
But what about documents, sir, that are from the real estate office, from the bank, from the tax office, or the tag office, documents that show Dr. Ferdinand sending out these internal memos to embarrass this person, these internal memos to say in writing that he doesn't believe she's qualified to be an elected commissioner? I mean, all these things.
As Mr. Sampson said, if you can identify specifically what you're talking about rather than make global statements about a stack of documents, because the response that we received on behalf of Dr. Ferdinand attached affidavits that were sworn testimony of people with firsthand information, as well as a copy of the deposition transcript for somebody testified under oath. That's the kind of evidence that we're looking for.
Well, I can point out each one to you, or if you just go from one to the other, this one is dealing with motor vehicle registration, and it talks about the interoffice memorandum put together by Dr. Ferdinand and one of his co-workers, and he sent it out to internal county manager, the board of commissioners. You've got a seven-day deadline, which was an arbitrary one, and it's listed here. You have documents stating from another, which I'm not. I've learned a lot over the last 20 years, but I'm not an attorney. But you have an attorney here that says, look, we have done this. And then there's a document that shows it was done. And what I'm asking you to look at is we've got an affidavit from the commissioner's sister and brother-in-law. We have the lease agreement. We have the document pertaining to the motor vehicle registration concerning the 2004 Jeep. All this information I brought you today, you cannot.
Chairman Edwards asked a question probably about 20 minutes ago, which is, and it appears I think you've answered the question. Is there anything in this particular allegation that doesn't stem directly from the complaint? And by the complaint, let me be specific. You have filed a complaint with us, but it appears that your information is derived from and without judging the value of the allegations in the complaint in Gwinnett County, I'm sorry, in Fulton County before Judge Lee, is there anything that you have to add to the allegations in that complaint that is being currently litigated, and apparently there's a pending motion for summary judgment in that action?
Well, I brought several copies of what I consider an information document put together from documents and put it in a form. My wife got them to me because I increased the font, but it helped my eyesight. But I'm trying to list in there the items that have occurred involving Dr. Ferdinand in several situations, and I can point to the exact pages dealing with his personal vendetta against Commissioner Houseman.
Is this a new complaint?
I put in a new complaint earlier this morning. This is more, I felt like, of an informational document to have here today when asked by the board if I had any
evidence.
Documentation, any evidence, anything that I could show you. I've taken a lot of information that is in other documents, you know, and some information that I might have put in there, you're going to say very quickly, I've heard it so many times, oh, you might have something in your white paper there that has to do with a newspaper article. Well, that's your side. I should have heard that so often. You know, I got a journalism degree, and I feel bad for reporters because lawyers are quick to say, or maybe the court says, well, that's just your side. Even if a reporter got the information through going through records, going through documents, and says at the end with a paragraph, which a lot of times the HAC does, that, you know, this is how we got it, this is where we got it, and we want to show that we can substantiate this story.
Are you telling us that this document here contains hearsay and that we should consider that? Is that one?
No, I'm just saying that I hear.
Okay. Well, I'm asking, does the document contain hearsay?
Not to my knowledge. I'm saying that it's possible that if I put a sentence or two sentences in there that I found, say, in an article written by say it was John Edwards from AJC or David Wickert from AJC, are you going to say, oh, well, we don't give credence to anything that the news media puts out?
Let me express Chairman's concerns here. From my reading of your complaints and issues regarding Tax Commissioner Ferdinand and Fulton County Commissioner Houseman, they all basically stem from a perceived retaliatory action by the Tax Commissioner against Commissioner Houseman. That retaliation is being made the subject of a complaint that's been filed not only by you in this ethics board, but is being litigated in the courts, Fulton County courts. And you are correct that we are not necessarily bound by deferring this action on your complaint because there's some other action going somewhere else that addresses the same or exact or very closely allied issues. But I have more confidence, quite frankly, in the extended and adversarial process of the judicial system than dealing with your ethics complaint on another matter, which may or may not have any effect, and I doubt that it would, on the Superior Court case, but I would rather see the matter decided between the parties, that's Commissioner Hausman and Tax Commissioner Ferdinand, and the adversarial process to come up with the truth ultimately as a result of that action than to than for this board to rely on, you know, the same type of paperwork and your allegations. It would be my preference to either defer to the decision of the Superior Court on this matter than for us to on our own and basically on a one-sided matter make a determination.
To be clear, you've noted before that we apply a legal standard. The ethical code is different than the tort that's being alleged in the Superior Court action, but the facts that you rely on appear to be identical, and it's the fact-finding role of the Superior Court that we think is going to be superior to our fact-finding role, given that it's the adversarial system and both sides have the opportunity to present evidence. What Dr. Ferdinand's attorney has asked us to do in the outset of the brief is to simply abstain. At least it's unclear whether they wanted to stay or whether they wanted us to defer to them entirely. I think it would be proper for us to abstain for the moment to the extent that facts are found in that action that warrant something. Well, then those are facts found by a superior court that we could probably rely on in this action if you want to bring the complaint again.
Yes, sir. From here, the chairman and yourself, I want to ask if we give Tanner, and representing Dr. Ferdinand, I agree with you. Is when you read what's happened and you read the documentation that was out there, if any of y'all had the feeling in your gut that maybe you can make a difference by joining this board or joining other associations and boards and do something that would help the community, that's what I'm concerned with. That is what I'm concerned with. So if you're saying that perhaps you could look at it after, and you know, if the area covers the ethics code, which I strongly do believe that section 2, 6A, 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 6 if the sections are looked upon after this court case, is that possible, Chairman?
Yes.
Depending on the facts that are found. I mean, sometimes.
I understand.
So it would be the chair's desire that it entertain, that this board entertain a motion to defer any action on the matter involving the Dr. Ferdinand and Ms. Hausman.
I think it would be proper. I would need to dismiss it.
Due to motion.
I'm sorry.
Mr. Anderson, and from what I read, the issue seems to be the question of Commissioner Hausman's address. Now, do you know whether or not Commissioner Hausman has provided to the tax commissioner her present address?
Yes.
A current address? She has provided
yes,
that
I
to
I have no personal knowledge or phone conversation from Commissioner Hausman or someone stating that, but it is in the documentation provided by her attorney that's representing her in this case that she's filed against Tax Commissioner Ferdinand. and that she was at all times, during a divorce, during her father dying, which was in the news story and so forth, at all times when she brought up things that really, I think, upset Fulton County citizens concerning Dr. Ferdinand's use of large reimbursements and expenses and going to all these places that's paid by the taxpayers. But to answer your question, yes, she stated, and they did a deposition, which is included.
Yeah, that's why I raised the question, because I read the deposition, yes. And I still didn't see where her parent address was provided to the tax commissioner, but if you say it has been, thank you.
Well, this right here is a copy of the lawsuit complaint that was filed by Commissioner Houseman's attorney, and it states and shows in the exhibits that she never was living outside District 3, that she was in her district, and even though she moved in with some others, you know, maybe financial problems as far as going through a divorce and other things, but she moved in with some other, she was living as far as residing in her area in Fulton County, but you got a tax commissioner that wanted to just make her bleed, make her sweat, make her hurt, and that is despicable. It's despicable.
Thank you.
I would move to dismiss without prejudice to Mr. Anderson or any other complaint, bring in a complaint on this issue, should they want to, after the Superior Court has made whatever factual findings could support such a complaint.
All right. Does everybody understand that motion? Mm-hmm. Is there a second to it?
I'll second.
Okay, the properly moved and seconded to dismiss without prejudice the Mr. Anderson's complaint in regard to the allegations of retaliation, etc., involving Commissioner Ferdinand and Commissioner Houseman. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right.
All those opposed by same sign. Okay.
Chairman, I want to thank the board for taking time to be here today, and at two items I brought before it, this one deferred or without prejudice, like you said. I thank you because at the last hearing, I was thinking I'd cross T's and dotted I's and so forth, and I believe that this board has given me sufficient time to say something that is coherent, and hopefully, sir, you have to bring me back if I stray too far. I appreciate your time today.
Okay, thanks. I think we have another matter. The other matter you brought, Mr. Anderson, relates to Mr. Ferdinand's
conservation.
And Mrs. Ferdinand, the tax commissioner's Ferdinand's use of the conservation use assessment. And as a result, receives a either some type of tax rebate or tax reduction on property that he has purchased. And you believe that to be a violation of the ethics code. Could you expand on it as briefly and as succinctly as you can, Mr. Anderson, why you believe that to be a violation of the code of ethics?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
OCGA 48-57.4 gives property owners or potential property owners the opportunity to take property not for commercial, not for residential, and allow them to apply for the what's called the conservation ease assessment. Now, I have looked and made copies of items on not only the commissioner's own website he created, but also the tax commissioner's website, which involved the tax assessor and any other information. I don't find it. Where I found it was specifically looking for this issue, because he has not only bought the property over a decade ago in a first complaint that I had filed, and I believe we were in this very room, Chairman, concerning how he used a straw man, a straw purchase, Tom Biggers, to purchase this property in South Fulton County. And at the time, I thought I had a legitimate complaint. The board felt otherwise and dismissed it. Now, he's taken the land, and so far he has, I think it's up to the tune of $40-something that he has received from the federal government.
$47.
$40,000, in that range, okay. I think it's $44,000. But the main topic here is that he stated February 18th right here, or was, I think it was in a news quote, that he's not only available for a citizen, Mayor Reed, but he's available to others that have problems. I couldn't find anything that shows that you have a type of training, whether it's some of his employees or if he took the time himself. He has knowledge, as many elected officials do. He has knowledge that goes to not only his education, not only his experience, but Dr. Ferdinand has also probably learned a lot being tax commissioner since 97, 99, sometime for a good while. Now, what he's been able to do is put his property in what's a 10-year covenant. And since it was 2003 and 4 that we were here, it seems like it would have ended 2013. So was what I understood, not your actual residence or commercial or timber or there's another one, but now he's got a small amount. I think they were saying, what I read was about 30 cattle. And an article states that he and his wife were quite happy, and I'm glad that they are. But, you know, this has been, since 2008, the worst recession since the Depression, and has affected a lot of people. Now, that's a glowing example here of what he's doing with federal money involving, again, NRCS, which is the Natural Resources Conservation Service, and also EQIP, Environmental Quality Incentives Program. You know, it's wonderful, and if you're just a lay person, you can do this, and sir, I have no problem with it. What I do have a problem with is when you take information that you learn in the process of being in the taxing business, and on the left-hand side, you have, you
Mr. Farid, so I can't see you very good, but when you take a position of trust, you are to do it in a fashion, fiduciary, for the public's trust, for public gain, not private or personal gain. I believe that through figures 17 and 18 show it here on page 30, and I'd like to show the board what I'm talking about. Apologize for only having one copy. Figures 17 and 18 below illustrate the amount of revenue loss and the ever-increasing amount of revenue removed annually from digest affected by the conservation use valuation program since 1997. It also states that Fulton County has lost $1,315,003 on these conservation use assessments that the taxpayers would have been able to utilize, whether it's parks and recreation, firefighters, employees of the county, etc. And what you've got that's been taking place is that the of the 53 counties in this report, this annual report, you had seven county tax digests that failed to meet the state standards for approval. And it states that Fulton County was, okay, here it is. OCGA section 4857.4 requires a report showing the fiscal impact of the law provided for a conservation use assessment. This report analyzes the adverse fiscal impact on taxpayers. And this report is available mainly in the circles of tax people. I mean, you're not going to have a citizen looking for this unless they just do research like I did. But what you have here is on page 10, and Chairman, I can either show it to you or I'd like to show it to Mr. Sampson, your attorney. Here you've got a $5 per parcel penalty that went to Fulton County only. Now,
Let me understand something. I'm not quite sure how this, what you're showing me now, relates to his use. And really,
I'm
what
share that
what,
with you right now.
What, yeah, because.
Yes, sir. Okay. If the tax commissioner was as vigilant as he has been, padding his pocket, making certain that he takes all federal advantages, all state and local advantages that he possibly can. The record shows that when he came in, I've read some stories and some information that states that he brought the percentage up in collections. And you've got part of the county commission and probably part of the county government of Fulton County saying, hey, but he's, you know, helping in this department, that department, so forth. You don't have an elected official that is really concerned for the people. That's where I get into those codes that I'll share with you I believe are violated, because you have the opportunity to be a public servant. You also have the opportunity to derive personal financial gain by insider knowledge, call it insider trading. They were talking about something in the news that I'd never heard of called front running. And I had to go look it up on the computer. I wanted to see what it was.
So if I understand you, what you're saying, that your allegation is that Dr. Ferdinand has basically engaged in what you term insider trading because of his knowledge of the tax code and the tax breaks that are available. By him taking advantage of those tax breaks, he has violated the ethics code.
You're not going to find, of course, insider trading that term, but what I'm saying is that he has used his office, his public office, not a fiduciary looking after the public trust, because you are working
the boss is up here, the public, the taxpayers, the citizens. A lot of them have been thrown out of their homes. A lot of them have been contacted by, whether it's Vesta Holdings or others, but you have a tax commissioner that is the greediest man I have encountered in years. I mean, it's one thing to do your job properly, and he's got a lot of personnel to help him do his job properly. It's another thing to put out as many liens as he can, put out as many applications with his insider knowledge, and use that public information for personal and private gain. And I'm stating that the Board of Ethics covers that.
List for me what code violations you believe have occurred.
And while you do that, if you could identify the specific insider information that you believe Dr. Ferdinand has used to his advantage that isn't publicly known.
Also, Mr. Anderson, would you not, I think you said before you had been an elected official, would you not see your salary as something different than the county money? And what you do with your personal money is different, because from the article, it does not appear that it was something that was that he was trying to do behind a closed door, because it's put out into the public. And because of your knowledge and being in the industry, you do tend to learn a lot, and you take that learning and you use it for the good. So would it not be separating his personal salary from what the county public salary, what the county public money is? What he does with his personal money really has nothing to do with the citizens or his ethics.
Yes, board member of the ethics board, yes. But I have tried to find if Dr. Ferdinand or any of his representatives or co-workers can tell me that this is happening, then you know I'll be much happier, and I'll feel that he has been more than fair. I can't find where anything revolving around this particular issue has been taught to citizens in seminars, on the website, you know. You've got, it states in several documents that Dr. Ferdinand is about the only one, in fact, in the document over here it says he's the only one in Fulton, and very, very few have done so in Gwinnett, but you've got the citizen that is also an elected official, a public servant, or supposed to be. So share, serve that, teach that, have a seminar. I've given seminars on ethics for 15, 18 years. Give it back to the people. What I'm saying is that, and I brought the new book, I got $2,000 worth of these years ago on city and county and held seminars on these things from the Carl Vincent Institute in Athens. But, you know, it talks about what tax commissioners are supposed to do. But there's nothing there that says he has to teach them. And as far as benefiting himself personally, I compliment you, sir, that you have enriched yourself. But a lot of that money that you're getting at close to $300,000-$400,000 a year could be better suited with the Fulton County Parks and Recreation or the Fulton County employees.
That would be more of a personal issue and not an ethical issue. Would you not agree?
I agree that Dr. Ferdinand, whether he has received this through just reading up on it, or whether he has received it as being tax commissioner of Fulton County, it's not something that a lot of his neighbors and a lot of other land property owners are aware of, and perhaps that would be something that he could do for others and share with them his success at gathering up 400,000 from people's misery, and then also getting federal money for his 68-70 acres in South Fulton. And probably, from what I've read, hardly spends out a dollar out of his wallet, because with the reimbursements and expenditures that go on, going on these trips during these tight financial times, when my wife and other teachers have been furloughed, state employees furloughed, Fulton County's tax office seems to have money for $39,000 new 2013 car for him and so forth. Mr. As far Chairman, as the
yes, I don't need to, but I think he's going too far out. I mean, we hear about ethics, and yeah, he had something to show me that he had personal gain for what he has done in the past, not by what his wife is earning and all the salaries and all that. I'm not here. I'm here. This is the ethics against the
government. Well, I have, you know, we can only go on what Mr. Anderson has written to us and what he stated at this hearing. One thing that seems rather ironic is that he's given to us a sheet from the Natural Resource Conservation Service, and presumably but this was just go out to Dr. and Mrs. Ferdinand, but was disseminated to public to encourage other people to know more about the program. And I do recall another favorable article in the HAC, which I believe was favorable, that describes the his taking a lawful advantage of certain federal programs that encourage conservation and increase yields in land. And I think that was another opportunity for people to know about it. I don't think he has any personal obligation to go door to door or anywhere else to share any information that he has about federal or state programs regarding conservation or environmental good farming practices. What I'd like to do now, Mr., because we are moving into, we do have some additional business, I'd like to, at this point, if there's anyone from Dr. Ferdinand's group here that likes to respond relatively briefly.
I would.
Okay, and then.
Chairman, could I answer his question real quick?
All right.
I was talking from section 271. New officer shall disclose, except required by law or otherwise, use confidential information acquired by virtue of his or her position in the county for his or her or another person's private gain, in order to advance his financial or personal interest, or the financial or personal interest of any person or business, for such use or conflict with the best interest of the county.
Mr. Anderson, my question was, what is confidential about this information? No, what?
Well, I thought you were asking earlier about the code section.
No, I ask about what portion of this information is confidential, or as you described it, insider.
Well, when I use the term insider, I was talking about his insider knowledge as a long-extended tax commissioner that might have learned of this information. And I was saying that if it was done through a public office, and he used it for his own personal and private gain, I would think that this is something that should be shared with everyone. I'm not saying that he didn't get this information on his own. I would like to hear from him how, if this was something that he did after he played this little transaction of having an employee of Fulton County purchase this property years ago, and it was all tied up to another third-party collection company. I will say this, from everything that I have looked into for the last few months, he definitely is on very good terms with these collection companies, and...
Just to turn your attention back to, the question wasn't did he learn about it while he was working for Fulton County. The question was, is it non-public information? The fact that there is a conservation use assessment program, you're not alleging that that is non-public?
Type it into Google and you've got the information.
Okay.
Let's just take a 3-minute break for Canada. Mr. Dr. Ferdinand can briefly respond. Is that all right?
That's fine.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson.
Thank you.
There is some water over here. Light. Anyone like it?
Okay, this is Julian. I think he's called me about my little buddy. He says it's ready, so I don't think it's going to let him know I got the voice and I'm on my way. All right,
Thank you.
right. Call the meeting to order, please. Dr. Ferdinand, the allegations that you have heard them relate to the use of the conservation service and the environmental quality incentive program where there's this good money.
Called CUPA. Called conservation evaluation assessment.
Okay. All right. Are we picking this up?
Chairman Edwards, do you want to swear the witness's testimony?
Yeah. Dr. Ferdinand, you swear the testimony you give in this matter would be the truth and the truth and nothing but the truth will help you guide.
I do. Okay.
Generally, we don't necessarily swear attorney.
Oh, I understand.
Okay.
But I will if you want me to.
No, perfectly. I'll take your word for it.
Okay, whatever would like to start out and you know, it's... if we can kind of keep to the point and just inform the board to specifically address or
that react. Would be my job.
Okay.
And then I have two things. First, the I heard the ethics violation being couched. It was that the tax commissioner used confidential insider information for his personal benefit. Then there was a peripheral subsequent fiduciary duty to inform the citizens. Right? Second is not an ethics issue, it's an aspirational issue. To the answer to that issue, the board members have handed a flyer that was prepared in 2003. And you will notice that on the this promulgated by Dr. Ferdinand. You'll notice in the right-hand column about two-thirds of the way down, it clearly identifies the existence of the conservation use evaluation for timberland and other purposes. So that particular document, which was promulgated to the public and to the taxpayers of Fulton County, answers two questions. A, it was not insider. And two, he did his job. The other piece of documentation, there's 159 counties in Georgia, and the CUVA is a farmer sensitive or sympathetic statute. It helps small farmers. You'll notice that under the code section, if you have over 2,000 acres, you cannot take advantage of it. The second document is titled 2011 CUVA Parcel Count Summary, and it lists the number of counties in the state and how many CUVAs existed in 2011, which was the last year of that we were able to pull the numbers up. I admire the petitioner's studiousness and his ability to research. But I will point out that in Floyd County right now, which is the home of his residence, there's 2,142 CUVAs of record. I think those two documents go to exactly the essence of the ethics complaint. A, primary ethics that he perverted his office by using unique insider information. We evidence that we did not. And second, that it was not available to the general public when in 2011 there were close to 173,000 taxpayers across the state. And in 2013, coming out of the greatest recession we've had, we now have 183,000 Thank you.
Any questions?
No, with the chairman entertain a motion.
Did you have anything to say?
There's nothing else to say, except that I go on public document. This went in every single tax year since I've been there, every year.
All right. Any questions? Yes, the board will entertain, the chair will entertain a motion.
I move that we dismiss the complaint for the CUVA, for Mr. Dr. Ferdinand's use of the CUVA. I believe Mr. Anderson's complaint was that it was done in violation of our code section. In section 266 of the Fulton County Code of Ethics, it clearly states in relevant part that no officer or employee of the county, except otherwise provided by law, should be denied the opportunity available to all other citizens to acquire and maintain private, economic, and other interests, except where a conflict of interest situation would necessarily result. There's been no information of a conflict of interest. There's been no evidence presented that this information was confidential. Instead, to the contrary, we've seen 10 years of published newsletters or pamphlets that have been submitted to the Fulton County residents. So I move that we dismiss the complaint for a lack of probable cause.
Is there a second?
I second that.
The property moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed by same sign. Appears unanimous.
Can I make an editorial comment here?
Yes.
I'm familiar with the CUVA. I'm in North Fulton, and they're actually viewed very positively up there because we're trying to slow down development. And the alternative to a horse farm is usually a subdivision. So this gives a landowner an opportunity to actually reduce his taxes and maintain some of the rural atmosphere of the community. So contrary to what Mr. Ferdinand is supposed to be doing, maximizing taxes, he's actually giving property owners. This law actually gives landowners an opportunity to reduce their tax liability. So. I mean, short of your 38 acres being a subdivision in Chattahoochee Hills, you're doing some really nice thing with some cattle and environmental things. So I applaud you for your activity down there. And I think the CUVA is a great thing. I hope we can retain it for years to come.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Any other comments?
No, sir. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There is another item. You don't need to be. Don't need to be here.
You're not to take
testimony. No. No, we're not. I would like you here. Yes, it should not take long.
Thank you.
The last item on our new business. Agenda is investigation of R.J. Morris ethics complaints regarding illegal tax erasures. When the chairman received this complaint from Mr. Morris, who's with us today, we were not exactly sure what illegal tax erasures meant, other than illegally going down to the tax records and in some way expunging the taxes due or in some way doing something that was contrary to law and ergo also contrary to ethics. I believe Mr. Morris's complaint stems from a Atlanta Journal-Constitution article. Because we couldn't get a clear understanding of what was Mr. Morris's complaint, after asking, giving Mr. Morris a call and also contacting the tax commissioner's office to see if there was something that was called a tax erasure. I would like to suggest to the board that rather than addressing this as a complaint for resolution, I mean, it came to us rather recently, and upon receipt of it, we passed it on to the tax commissioner's office. What I would like to suggest to the board is that we ask our general counsel to, one, get a copy of the order, which may expand, I mean, copy of the article, which may expand the crux of Mr. Morris's complaint, and then follow up with any other person, including Mr. Morris and Dr. Ferdinand or anyone in his office, and then report back to us within 30 days. What his conclusions are, or what his recommendations are, conclusions are, and to determine if there is a matter that we need to formally enter as a complaint and request that Mr. Ferdinand provide a written response, or provide a response. Would that satisfy you at this point, Mr. Morris?
Well, I have some concern with that. And may I approach her? Do I need to talk
you,
again?
Well,
I'll make it concise. Basically, what I did is, these are just words that I used, was erasure. Erasure in the dictionary, anyone knows, means to remove. So if you want me to amend it to simpler terms, I can make it simpler and say, he removed it. And so what I did is I made, after receiving your email, I made a more concise statement here and showed the applicable law. And so this is all I have to say. By the way, Dr. Ferdinand, I have to congratulate you on the conservation easement and or the conservation exemption or anything. I think every citizen ought to use it. I have no problems with it, although that's unrelated. I just wanted to tell him that I don't think that's something that anyone should not do. I just want the school to get their money back. That's it.
Well, our counsel will look into it. You'll be kept apprised of whatever comes out of it.
That's fair. I just want to make sure you understand it's not a term. I didn't use the legal term. It's extinguished. This other term is removed. So there seems to be some confusion over the word erasure, but it's in the dictionary.
Just so I understand, as I read the first paragraph here, it says, thus the commissioner did legally erase. You mean to say legally erase these taxes?
Yes, there's two parts, as you'll see in the law. If you look at the reference down below, you can legally erase through the land bank, city, county taxes, and the land bank has that full authority. But if you go further and erase more taxes, school district taxes, then the law is definitive that you shall first obtain. You can't go back, you shall do it. I think even the attorney will say, if you see a word in the code section that says shall, you don't have a choice, you have to do this.
Okay.
Any other questions? Is that good? Thank you very much.
Thank
for your time.
You.
I appreciate
Thank
it.
You. All right. Okay. We did skip over one new issue here. Number two, attorney's fees for filing frivolous complaints. One of my concerns, and I think it should be a concern of all of the board here is to, you're free to go if you wish.
Thank you.
Free to stay if you wish. Is that from time to time, more recently than in the past, I think that there have been matters brought to us in the form of a complaint that as long as it alleges something in violation, some action in violation of our code, including the general overall characterization of something that is in violation of the law, which would be also a violation of ethics. If it's notarized, then the present code requires us to meet within 30 days to receive it and provide a response. Of course, what that means is that every time we meet, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times 150. Okay, not that, you know, it's a significant burden upon the county, but you know, it is about $1,500 that comes out even on matters that are plainly baseless just by the initial reading. The city has, of course, has a budget and has an ethics officer that they pay, and she has the, under their code, has the authority to kind of sift through and weed out complaints that are, for one reason or another, without any merit. And I'd like to see in some way where we can formulate a request to the commission to amend the complaint so that we, amend the code so that we have some type of filtering that will not require us to assemble a quorum and deal with matters that on its face really do not present a ethical issue or question or problem. Now, one can review this latest latest complaint, new ethics complaint against Dr. Arthur Ferdinand, dated March the 28th, at which you will all receive. You have not received it, I don't believe.
No, he
didn't
receive it.
And it has a lot of, well, it has no, no particular allegation that has not been already been addressed, and has many very conclusory, whatever it is. I don't know how to put it, but very demeaning might be a possible word, but it albeit. It appears also just to be a rather rambling vent about a lot of generalities from Mr. Anderson. Obviously, you know, I think we're going to have to, at this point, submit it for consideration and give it a response. That is justified by it, but this kind of reflects why we should have some type of filtering process. I, I had been trying to determine what that would be in light of how we're set up. And I'm open to ideas. I don't know if we're able to provide for fees or some type of reimbursement to the county or whatever the fees that are incurred.
I can look at other jurisdictions and see what they do, and make it if you want me to, and see how they address that. One idea would be to have a filtering process in terms of having certain rules regarding the structure
and style of compliance.
Right, exactly. You know, it has to allege facts, it has to allege specific allegations. They have to,
code section.
You have to identify the exact
what code section. That type of thing, might take care of some of these complaints that don't really tie in a specific ethical violation to an employee and facts that support it.
Rather than trying to recreate the wheel, I think your suggestion of looking at other codes and seeing what filtering mechanism they may have employed, I don't know how big of a problem this will continue to be, but to some degree, weighs on.
Well, I think it's likely to happen within 2 or 3 days after Dr. Ferdinand's picture's in the paper. But which has been the practice of the past. So when you'll see this, you'll see, basically what we're talking about, and we'll scan it and email it to everybody, including Dr. Ferdinand.
I've not been on the board that long, but has this happened several times before?
Well, he is a frequent, and I don't mind Mr. Anderson bringing to us, substantive matters, but when he just kind of alleges insults and repeats them, and Dr. Ferdinand is making too much money, and that the Board of Ethics is a lame duck, and when the commissioners say something, we quack. What is that? But yeah. So this is what is notarized. So we probably have to address it. I may call, with the board's permission, may call Mr. Anderson and, indicate that we've read it. Would he consider withdrawing it? And then we'll let you know.
We first saw him about 10 years ago when Dr. Ferdinand bought the property. The 68 acres down, or 38 acres down there, and that was a real interesting deal, and it was a little bit squeamish the way that whole thing and why it happened the way it did, and I can understand why Mr. Anderson might have raised a flag about that, but that was 10 years ago, and it's done, and he's still bringing it up, and I think to your point, Don, is this is a perfect example, this conservation use complaint. There was absolutely nothing wrong with it. It was all within the guidelines, and Mr. Anderson had not done his homework. And if he had, he would have known that nothing Dr. Ferdinand did was against the law. It was perfectly legitimate. He qualified on all the criteria. It's a legitimate conservation use application down there. So there was no basis for any kind of a complaint other than he just seems to have it out for the tax assessor.
Well, having it out for the tax assessors has been from a historical and biblical perspective, and literary one, not unusual. But this is not the sheriff of Nottingham, and you know, and I don't think Mr. Anderson is Robin Hood. And so what we need to do is just try to, it's not necessarily targeted at Mr. Anderson, but targeted at anyone who just kind of feels that they need to express themselves, but when there's no substance to that expression other than derogatory references and insulting names and things of that nature, albeit notarized. That, okay, all right. All right, thanks. We do something about it. So,
I make a motion that we are, you know, like put this on to begin new business for further discussion at the next board meeting.
Okay.
We'll have time to look at it and see how to figure out how to filter out stuff such as these complaints. That's not, doable. I mean, I can't say that we've had the commissioner, chairman of the board of commissioners in here as an ethical complaint, which we found it was, you know, his fault or whatever. He was complaining against someone else.
Yeah.
So we just need to be able to filter out stuff like that. So,
right.
And how,
okay. Well, you know, that's. Our general counsel's charge, along with getting information regarding Mr. Morris's complaint. So, if there's no. Okay, there's a motion.
Yeah, I want a motion to table, you know, discussion until next meeting.
Okay, and you move to adjourn.
Now.
Okay, and there being a second.
I second that.
Okay. Probably motion and second that we adjourn until our next meeting, which will be called at a time when we're able to assemble a quorum and have some information back from our general counsel. Thank you again for being present and participating.
Chairman Edwards.
Okay, what do you want to take?
Email
at
11 o'clock
last
night.
Did you see my response? Well,
I wasn't in the office.
I mean,
they said
yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, to me,
well,
you know,
yeah, well,
this
well,
is
a lot of stuff.
I thought I'm trying to be inside.
And
violated the law.
But yeah.
So did I hear YouTube in your introduction?
Yeah.
Okay, but you know, you
really?
Okay.
Yeah. Is that like C-SPAN or something?
All right.
I'll see you next time.
Well, that's a good way to put yourself to sleep watching that stuff. These get a little more lively. Do you have a card?